Joyce, here I am.
Hey.
Well, Joyce picked me because we like music. We like ragtime music and we like American popular music. And I'm a big collector. Besides being in the piano business, I'm a big collector and I have been since I'm a little kid of old phonograph records and sheet music. When I started collecting, I was picking up old records on the sidewalk in the streets where I used to live. And I would play those records on whatever turntable I found in the garbage on the sidewalk. So I grew up listening to music, even though my high school pals would be listening to Elvis Presley and the Four Seasons and Johnny Ray occasionally. I was listening to Al Jolson and Georgie Price and a lot of the people from the early part of the century. From 1900 up until 1940, mostly, or the early 50s, anyway. So I started collecting records and then sheet music. And what I liked about the records were the music, the lyrics, the melodies, and I learned a lot of them by accident. I didn't study any of them, but I know a lot of them just by hearing them. In any event, I started collecting sheet music. What I liked about sheet music was the fact that on the music you had beautiful graphics. You had either pictures of the songwriters or the performers, because the sheet music was made to sell. And in order to sell the music, they had to have something on the cover, because just opening the inside and seeing black dots on a white page didn't excite people enough to buy the music. So, especially if they didn't know the music, they needed to see something on the cover. So, there were artists, special artists, that just drew and made graphic art for the covers of sheet music, and that's how it was displayed in the stores. On the cover, also, besides the photographs from movies or Broadway shows, they had the name of the songwriters. First, the lyricist on the left, and then the composer that did the music on the right. Usually, there were two songwriters, or three or four, even. Occasionally, there was one songwriter. There were very few people that could write words and music. There were two different talents. And you had people like Irving Berlin and Cole Porter, Meredith Willson also, and they did the words and the music to most of their own songs. So, growing up, while I was in school, I would be collecting music and collecting records, and I collect other things as well. But music was always there in the background. And then once I moved to Long Island, I got out of the automobile business where I was, and I started working on pianos because when I was growing up, I always wanted a piano. And we couldn't afford a piano. We had no space where I was living. So I put that on the back burner. But once I got to Long Island, I found a piano and I brought that into my house. And I was perfectly happy. And I decided to work on it and fix it. I'm a mechanic by nature, so I could take apart a piano and put it back together and refinish it like I did automobiles. And then I decided more and more I liked to get into the piano business. So I advertised in the Yellow Pages at that time. And before I even had a store, I got a phone call. I got a phone call from a fellow. I was in my house and I got a call from this fellow who wanted to move a piano. I had never moved a piano before, but I'm willing to do anything. So I said, yes, sure, I'll help you move the piano. And this fellow who called me, his name was Oscar Brand. And I heard the name, but I didn't know who it was exactly. It turns out Oscar Brand was a very famous, well-known, big-time folk singer. And he had been in the folk singing business his whole life. And he was just getting a piano from somebody in Great Neck where he lived, and he wanted help to move it there to his house. So I took my little pickup truck and I went to see the piano with him, and we loaded up his baby grand piano in my pickup truck and I brought it to his house, and we became friends after that. Also, it turns out that at that time, Oscar Brand was becoming the curator of a new museum in New York City called the Songwriters Hall of Fame on 42nd Street and Broadway. Now, in school, when I was growing up, most people were interested in the people who were performing. Everybody would love to have met the Elvis Presley or the Beatles, all the performers. But I was interested in meeting them, certainly. Occasionally, I would meet somebody at a show, but I was really interested more in the songwriters, the people who made the songs, who were obscure in many cases, but certainly accessible, which a lot of the big performers were not. So I was thrilled to be involved with the Songwriters Hall of Fame, because every time they had a party for songwriters, it was open to the public most of the time, but then they had parties for the songwriters, many of whom lived in New York City. And when they came to the Songwriters Hall of Fame party, they would invite me, since I had donated a piano. I only had three pianos at that time, and I donated one of them, since Oscar Brand said he needed a piano for his museum, so I gave him a piano. And after that, I went to every party that they ever had. And I met all kinds of amazing people who I was so thrilled to meet, the giants in the music industry. And now we're going to actually show you some of the people that I had met. I met many, but I didn't take pictures of everybody.
Okay. Go from beginning.
Yes, well, from beginning. Okay, here we go. Then.
There you go.
But now we're going to see the first one that'll show you is Hoagy Carmichael. Now, Hoagy Carmichael lived in California, so he didn't come to these meetings very often, but he did come to one. I remember it was in February, and he was complaining bitterly about how cold it was. Hoagy was a musician, and he wrote a lot of great music in the 1920s and 30s. Lazy Bones, Georgia on My Mind, Stardust is his most famous piece, even though his mother liked One Morning in May better. And here is a little sample of what he wrote.
Georgia, Georgia, the whole thing. Just an old sweet song keeps Georgia on my mind.
Georgia on my mind.
Now, Hoagy Carmichael wrote that with, he didn't actually write with anybody. He was a musician. So he wrote these pieces of music, and most of them got published by Mills Music. Some of them he did a lyric to, but often somebody else wrote the lyrics for him. It was a different skill that people had, generally speaking. There was a musician who could write music, and then there was a lyricist who was skilled in the English language. So his most famous song, Hoagy's song, turned out to be Stardust. And the lyric to that was written by Mitchell Parrish, and we'll talk more about Mitchell Parrish, the lyricist, later. Now, after Hoagy Carmichael, we have another interesting fellow genius too, Sheldon Harnick. And Sheldon Harnick, the lyricist, wrote Fiddler on the Roof, Broadway shows, Fiddler on the Roof, Fiorello, and She Loves Me, among others. He lived to be 99 years old. Now, one of the interesting things about Sheldon, he told me, was that when he wrote the music to Fiddler on the Roof, there are about 10 songs in that, 12 songs in that show. But he actually wrote 50 songs for that show, and the rest they just discarded. But one of my favorites, and my favorite lyric of his, especially now being very pertinent.
What do you say, Ben? Want a hand?
No, you guys go ahead. I got too much on my mind of late, poker.
Hey, Ben.
Cost you five. Only up to you.
Tell me
what you're gonna do.
I did. Gentlemen, here we are, and one thing is clear. We gotta pick a candidate for Congress this year. Big eight.
You'll pay through the nose.
Okay, what do you think? So am I.
Likewise. Possible straight, possible flush. Nothing, gentlemen. How about some names we can use? Some qualified Republican who's willing to lose.
How about the men that fire the gun?
Which way are you thinking of, Jack B or Jack Y? I say neither one. I never even met him.
I say, when you got a pair of jacks, man up.
Politics and polls, politics and polls, shuffle up and call up and find the soul. He became for children, he became his son.
I particularly like that one, especially nowadays, because politics is always quite fascinating. And so it was when he wrote that. It's a great show, Fiorella. And next we have a fellow who I did not meet at the Songwriters Hall of Fame. I got very lucky one day. I saw an ad in Newsday, or it was the New York Times probably, that a fellow by the name of Domenico Modugno was going to be at Carnegie Hall, his first trip to this country, and one night only at Carnegie Hall. Now, I became friends with songwriters along the way after meeting them, and one of the people I became friendly with was Mitchell Parrish, who wrote 700 songs, mostly unknown to other people. But one of the songs he put a lyric to, he was a lyricist, and he didn't write with anybody. He wrote lyrics to songs that had already been written. And one of the songs he wrote, one of the lyrics he wrote for a song, this was an Italian song, very popular in Italy. He did two of them. One was called Nel Blu Dipinto di Blu, which over here that's called Volare. And he also did Ciao Ciao Bambino, and they were written by Domenico Modugno. So of course I had to meet Domenico Modugno, who was Mitchell's writing partner in a way.
Volare, oh, cantare, oh. Let's fly way up to the clouds, away from the maddening crowd.
Now, Mitchell would work for various publishing companies, and they had in their catalog music that was written in this country mostly, but they did also some foreign music. And this was a very popular song, and they brought it over here, and it became even more popular once there was a lyric attached to it. Now, that's an interesting point. Music itself could be very beautiful, and it could be entertaining, and you could play it on the piano or other instruments, you could whistle it, but when it comes to singing it, you needed a lyric. And most of the popular songs that become very popular became popular because of the lyric that was attached to them. If they didn't have a lyric attached to them, they sat around for years as an instrumental. And I'll mention some of those later. Now we have a real character. Cab Calloway is, what can you say about Cab Calloway? You have to see them to believe him. If you watch Michael Jackson doing his moonwalk, his moon dance, then you'll see where it came from, because Cab Calloway in 1931 was doing that. And he wrote some songs himself, but he was a real performer. He was mainly a singer and performer leading his orchestra. And I didn't meet him at the Songwriters Hall of Fame either. I met him once at Belmont Racetrack because he liked the horses, and another time at a party for the 1000th anniversary of the big broadcast radio show. Of course, that was Minnie the Moocher. The first two lines of it were written by Mitchell Parrish. The rest was written by Cab. Even though on the music it says Mills. Mills was the name of the publishing company. And occasionally, maybe more than occasionally, one of the owners of the company, Irving Mills, would put his name on the record or the sheet music, indicating that he was part of the writing team. And they did that because it increased their percentage of compensation for the writing. It was called the cut-in. And some major performers did that as well. Now we have one of the biggest lyricists that people know, Sammy Kahn. Sammy Kahn wrote probably a couple of thousand songs. The first one was by Mere Mr. Shane, his first big hit from 1937. But he became very famous because he hooked up early on with Frank Sinatra, and most of the songs, dozens of songs that Frank Sinatra sang were written, the lyrics were written by Sammy Kahn. Here's one, for example.
Just what makes that little old man think he'll move that rubber Anyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant.
But he's got a heart. He's got a heart. He's got pineapple pie in the star.
Now, the thing I remember about Sammy Kahn, when I met him a number of times, but what I remembered most about Sammy Kahn was he was very sharp, very quick. He could write a lyric while he was talking to you and have it done in 15 minutes. But most songwriters in their life are asked occasionally by somebody or other that which comes first. People always ask songwriters which comes first, the words or the music. And most of the time, 99.5% of the time, it's the music that comes first, although sometimes a lyric comes first and music is put to it later. Such as a Mitchell song, which was called Hands Across the Table. That was a lyric first and then music was added to it. And also Santa Claus is Coming to Town was written as a poem or as lyric, and then music was added to that by J. Fred Coots and Haven Gillespie, who wrote the lyric. But in any event, when asked which comes first, the words or the music, Sammy Kahn's standard answer was the telephone call. Now we have another genius, Harold Arlen. Harold Arlen, I mean, it just mentioned a few of the things that Harold Arlen wrote, and it really says it all. Some of the songs he wrote were in movies and shows such as Over the Rainbow. But here's one that was in a movie by the Marx Brothers called At the Circus. And the lyric for this was written by another genius who unfortunately I never met, Yip Harburg. At least I don't think I met him. I met a lot of people, but I don't remember meeting Yip.
Ah, this meeting brings back memories. Childhood days, lemonade, romance. My life was wrapped around the circus. Her name was Lydia. I met her at the World's Fair in 1900, marked out in 1940. Ah, Lydia. She was the most glorious creature under the sun. Ice! You ready? Gobble. Rolled into one. Oh.
Lydia, oh, Lydia, say, have you met Lydia? Lydia, the fast lady. She has eyes that both adore, so, and a claw, so even more. So, Lydia, oh, Lydia, that encyclopedia. Oh, Lydia, the queen of tattoos. On her back is the Battle of Waterloo. Beside is the wreck of the Hesperus, too. And proudly of all waves, the red, white, and blue, you can learn a lot from Lydia. When a robe is unfurled, she will show you the world. If you step up and tell her where. For a dime, you can see Kankakee or Paris or Washington crossing the Delaware. Oh, Lydia, oh, Lydia, say, have you met Lydia? Lydia, the past lady. When our muscles stop, relax, and off the hill comes Andrew Jackson. Lydia, oh, Lydia, that encyclopedia. Oh, Lydia, the queen of them all. For two bits she will do a mazurka in jazz. With a view of Niagara that nobody has. And on a clear day you can see Alcatraz. You can learn a lot from Lydia. Long sleeve of Buffalo Bill with his lasso, just a little classic by Mendelssohn. Here is Captain Spaulding exploring the Amazon. Here's Godiva, but with her pajamas on. Here's Roma
Now, doesn't that lyric just make that song? I mean, just like politics and poker. Just like politics and poker. How can you have the music without that lyric? Makes you feel good. Now we're talking about Edward Eliscu. Edward Eliscu is an interesting fellow. He wrote some really beautiful lyrics. My favorites are Without a Song and More Than You Know.
That old sailor, an old fire, sing an old song, rolling dog, you'll be all by the sea. A young sailor, he's fine to sing a new song, flying down to Rio, come with me, where the lovely Brazilian ladies will catch your eye by the light of a million stars in the evening sky. My Rio, Rio by the sea, flying down to Rio, where there's rivers of hey, fellas, whirl that old propeller. Got to get to Rio, and we've got great time. Ooh, love it, soaring high above it, looking down on Rio from a heaven of blue. Send the radio to Rio de Janeiro with a big hello, just so they'll know it. And by there, we'll fly there. Oh, Rio, everything will be okay. We'll sing and wing our way. That was Flying Down to Rio from a movie called Flying Down to Rio from 1933, and Vincent Humans wrote the music to that. It's really quite beautiful. He wrote a lot of wonderful music, Vincent Humans did. That's Fred Astaire, who not only was he a pretty good dancer, he was a pretty good singer as well. Now, who do we have next? Oh, now we have Jay Gorney. Jay Gorney was a musician and a composer. And the picture of me with Jay Gorney was taken at the Songwriters Hall of Fame. But I really knew of Jay Gorney before that, but I didn't know I knew him. And the reason I say that is because even though he lived four blocks away from me in Manhattan on West 70th Street and West End Avenue and 70th, when I went to camp and I was 8 or 9 years old, I had one of my friends whose name was Danny Gorney. Who knew at that time
that was the son of this amazing person. And he wrote a song that is one of the most beautiful songs, amazing songs that ever was written. Also a lyric by Yip Harburg, Brother, Can You Spare a Dime? And this version by Al Jolson, to me, is the best one. By the way, I might add or interject at this point that all of this PowerPoint presentation was put together by Joyce. And Joyce Richardson not only put together the PowerPoint presentation and the photographs which she found and the sheet music which she found, but also she picked all of the musical segments and the records to play. So this is another one of Joyce's creations.
They used to tell me I was doing a dream, and so I followed the mob. When there was earth to plow or guns to bear, I was always there, right on the job. They used to tell me I was building a dream, with peace and glory ahead. Why should I be standing in line, just waiting for bread? Once I built a railroad, made it run, made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once I built a tower to the sun, brick, mortar, and lime. Once I built a tower, now it's done. Brother, can you spare a dime? Once in khaki suits, he will look swell, full of that Yankee doodly dumb. Half a million boots went marching through hell, and I was a kid with a drum. Hey, don't you remember? They called me Al. It was Al, Al all the time. Hey, don't you remember? I'm your pal. Brother, can you spare a dime? One time on a railroad, I made it run, and I made it race against time. Once I built a railroad, now it's done. Hey, brother, you ain't got a dime about you, have you? And once I built a tower, yes, a tower to the sun, a brick, water, and lime. Yes, I'm the fella built a tower, and now it's done. Hey, buddy, ain't got a dime about you, have you? Once in khaki suits, he will have swell, full of that Yankee doodle dee dum. Half a million boots went marching through hell, and I was a kid with a drum. Say, don't you remember? Don't you remember? They called me Al. It was Al, Al all the time. Don't you remember? I'm your pal. Brother, can you spare a dime?
That song done by him always gets me. It's just the most amazing emotional song. So to lighten up a little bit, we're going to do one more. One more song that he wrote the music to, Baby Take a Bow, and if you're a Shirley Temple fan, you may remember it. Thank you.
personnel. I'm presenting you right now. Baby, take a bow. Everybody wants to know where I found the lovely cameo. I'm presenting you right now. Baby, take a bow. Hear them whispering, hasn't she got everything? You're a standout. Listen to the compliments they hand out. Let me stand right up and say, meet the future Mrs. Hemingway. I'm presenting you right now. Baby, take a bow.
For that was Lou Brown, who did a lot of the work with De Silva and Henderson. De Silva, Brown and Henderson was a big songwriting team. They did a lot of songs in the late 20s and early 30s. Now we get to Buddy Green. Buddy Green was a delightful fellow who wrote some interesting songs, the most famous of which is R2 of actually Alabama Bound and Sentimental Journey. That's my weakness now also, but he also did another song called, as a lot of songwriters would do, wrote occasionally things that were humorous. He wrote one called I'm the Gypsy from Poughkeepsie, but we're not going to play that one. We're going to do one by Eddie Cantor called Alabama Bound.
I'm Alabama Bound, there'll be no heebie-jeebies hanging around. All I'm worth to put my precision up a berth, just hear that juju sound. I know that soon we're gonna cover ground, and then I'll follow so the world will know. Here I go, I'm Alabama bound. I can hear that choo-choo whistle blow. Watch that engine when we start to go. Now we're in Baltimore, knocking at Dixie's door. Watch that bill, Louisville, we passed that before. Feel the cotton, tell me where I am. Hear that fella yelling, Alabama. Mammy, Mammy, get your kisses ready for your honey lamb. I'm Alabama bound. There'll be no heebie-jeebie hanging round. To pay the meanest ticket man on earth. All I'm worth to put my precision in a cupboard. I'm just a lucky, lucky hound. To have someone to put my arms around. That's why I'm counting for the world to know. Here I go. I'm Alabama bound.
Now we're going to close the program with the last, but certainly not the least, of the Songwriters, Mitchell Parrish. Mitchell Parrish was a lyricist who, unlike the songwriters that wrote as a team, like Lerner and Lowe, and Rodgers and Hart, and Rodgers and Hammerstein, who wrote together for purposes like a movie or a Broadway show, Mitchell was a staff lyricist. He worked for a few different companies, Robbins and Mills and Joe Morris, and he wrote lyrics on demand for songs for music that was already written and published, even though the music wasn't played much before he put a lyric to it. His first song, Mitchell was born in 1900, July 10th, 1900, died in 1993. But I spent most of my time, of all the songwriters that I had ever known, I spent most of it with Mitchell. And he had a big hit in 1920. It was his first song, Manana, and then Carolina Rolling Stone in 23, and then Riverboat Shuffle in 24. Then a whole bunch of songs in the mid-20s that he had to actually write under a pseudonym because he was writing too many songs with his name that the publishing company was getting overwhelmed by seeing his name every place. But then he had an interesting occasion in 1929. There was a song that Mills had, like many songs of Hoagie Carmichael, they had the catalog. And Irving Mills would have said to Mitch, taking a piece of music in his hand and said, "Hey, Mitch, see what you can do with this." And Mitchell couldn't do anything with it because it was a fast song, which lent itself to a lyric that he couldn't figure out how to write. But then this is 2 years after the music was written. The music was written in 1927. And in 1929, he got a piece of this music to try to write a lyric, which he couldn't at that time. But then he heard Isham Jones Orchestra playing it. Mitchell used to be out every night at different clubs and musical venues, you know, listening to music and getting ideas. He heard Isham Jones playing it slowly. And then he had the idea, a ballad. So he put words to the music that Hoagie Carmichael had written, and the song Stardust became the most popular song in American history. It's been recorded by at least 1,800 different singles, people, groups. That's a picture of me pushing Mitchell in his wheelchair. He wouldn't let anybody else handle him except me. He was very fussy about people. And we're walking down the sidewalk in Manhattan on the way to probably the barber or someplace that he wanted to go. And he wrote about 700 songs, 35 of which were popular. Now Stardust, that didn't become anything until it had a lyric. He wrote another song in 1939, 5 years after the music was written. He wrote the words to Deep Purple that had been written as a longer piece of music, a novelty piano solo in 1934 by Peter DeRose. And it was played very rarely. But once he put a lyric to it in 1939, it became the most popular song of 1939. Not only did one song come out of that orchestral piece of music, two songs. There's another one he put lyrics to, another melody there, and it became another song called Lilacs in the Rain. Now, the lyrics themselves, as far as I'm concerned, are the key to making the song popular. And of course, they sold the sheet music based on the covers. They did a lot of graphic arts, which at another meeting with you all, I can do just graphic sheet music covers, which is a whole category by itself of incredible artwork. Most of these are just simple and basic, but they're incredible songs that were written words. For instance, my favorite one of a lyric is one of my favorites is a song that the melody goes <laughs> which doesn't do much for you. You can whistle it or sing it or have whistle it or have an orchestra play it, but you can't sing it. And that melody was written by J. Fred Coote in 1938. He had a big hit before that, 4 years before that, called Santa Claus is Coming to Town. And the lyric of Santa Claus is Coming to Town and his 1938 song, You Go to My Head, is just the most incredible lyric. I mean, if you see it and you read it or sing it or hear somebody performing it, it gets to me. I don't know how it gets to anybody else, but it's just great. So that's the last song, except for my finale, because in 1987, knowing that most people didn't know much about Mitchell Parrish, they knew about Duke Ellington, but they didn't know Mitchell wrote the lyric to Sophisticated Lady. They knew about Stardust, they knew Hoagy Carmichael, but they didn't know about Mitchell, and on and on and on and on. So I decided, after I heard some people put together a little review off Broadway, I got involved, and I was one of the producers of a Broadway show, which was called Stardust, which was 35 of the most popular of Mitchell's songs. The other songs that he wrote, besides the 35, the other hundreds of songs he used to call canines, and they didn't go too far. But this is the piece of music that we played in the theater as the people were coming in and sitting down.
And now the purple dusk of twilight time steals across the meadows of my heart. High up in the sky, the little stars fly, always reminding me that we're apart. You wander down the lane and far away, leaving me a song that will not die. Love is now the stardust of yesterday. The music of the years gone by. Sometimes I wonder why I spend lonely nights dreaming of a song, a melody taught in a reverie, and I am once again when our love was new. And each kiss an inspiration, but that was long ago. Now my consolation is in the stardust of a song. Beside the garden wall, when stars are bright, you are in the heart. Nightingale tells his fairy tale of paradise where roses bloom. Though I dream in vain, in my heart it will repay my
thank you all for listening and watching. And thank you, Joyce, for putting this wonderful program together. And I hope I get to speak with you and see you all with some other programs that I could put together. What I'm looking to do next for my next act is to take these hundreds of thousands of pieces of music, sheet music and phonograph records and player piano rolls and pianos and everything else that I have in my collection and make a music museum out of them. So if anybody out there wants to participate in building a music museum, you can contact me anytime. In the meantime, if you have any questions, I'm here to answer them.
Hey, I thank you, Rick. And if anyone has any questions, I encourage you to type them into your chat and then we can read them. And while we have people who are typing in their questions for the chat, I have a question for Mr. Rick. I would like to know about what year did you first meet Mitchell Parrish?
Probably 1970. Well, I spoke to Oscar Brand around 1975. I started getting into pianos in 73 when the ragtime craze began. And at the Songwriters Hall of Fame began probably in the mid-70s, 75 or 6. And I think I met Mitchell probably about 1977. He wasn't in a wheelchair at that time. But I met him then and we stayed in touch. And I spent a lot of time with him the last 15 years of his life, interviewing him and recording him and taking him to the barber and chiropodist and every place else he wanted to go, including the Grateful Dead concert at Madison Square Garden.
Hey, well, I'm looking in the chat. I don't see any questions, not yet. But before we close, I would like to say that our next webinar is going to be October the 12th at 3 p.m. And that's where I'm going to be talking about my father, Dr. Herbert N. Richardson, who was the first Black teacher hired in the Perth Amboy, New Jersey public school system. And well, Mr. Rick, I would like to thank you for your time. It seems like we have no questions.
I must have covered all the bases well enough.
I guess you did.
Well, if they have any more questions, they can reach me at the Piano Exchange, 516-671-6515.
All right. Well, thank you all for listening, and good night.